But what does moving forward look like? Does this mean the closer I get to Jesus, the more I gotta step out of my comfort zone? And so here is Peter out on the deep, too far to turn back, but it's scary moving forward. And so what does he do? He just stops and he notices wind and he begins to sink. And here's the interesting thing. The scripture tells us when he begins to sink, he reaches out his hand and he grabs Peter. This lets me know that Peter was almost. Peter was right. Somebody say he was right there. He was right there when he began to sing. Some of you are right there. You're right there. And you're in this place where you've come too far to go back. But for one reason or other, you're afraid to move forward. And what happens when this takes place? If you can remain standing, we're coming out of Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33, and it reads this. It says, immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. Somebody say the other side. While he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now evening came, and he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a ghost. And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. Somebody say, don't be afraid. And Peter answered and said to him, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. So he said, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, oh, you of little faith, why do you doubt? And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. You can be seated this morning. Well, I hope you guys are doing okay from yesterday. From last week. Everybody's good? Yes. Praise the Lord. I'm good. Well, today is part two of actually the final part of a two-part series entitled Better. This year is this day is part two. We're calling it Farther from Familiar. From familiar. Last week we talked briefly about, we talked about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and this fire that they were thrown into, and realizing that Nebuchadnezzar had to call them out of a fire that was heated up 7 times hotter than it normally is. And we beg the question, what must have been happening in that furnace for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to have to be needed to be called out from such a painful situation? They must have been enjoying their time in the fire. And we discover, what must the word be telling us about that situation? And we put it into one sentence or one phrase: better to be in the fire with Jesus than in the world without him. And so part two, we're going to explore. Last week we were in the fire. This week, somebody say, we're going to get in the water. Last week was the fire. This week is the water. Listen, there is a region of our country that is home to what is called Tornado Alley. Tornado Alley. This central U.S. area encompasses much of northern Texas, northward through Oklahoma, Kansas, Missouri, and parts of Louisiana, Iowa, Nebraska, and eastern Colorado. If you're watching online in any of those places, God bless you. Please don't hate me. I'm just using this as an analogy. But you do live in Tornado Alley. Now, here's the reality. Meteorological, I can't stand that word, research, it shows that some 40% of all U.S. tornadoes occur in Tornado Alley. 40%, almost half of all tornadoes take place here in Tornado Alley. And this isn't by chance. It's not just happenstance. It doesn't just pop up this way. The reality is there is a pattern, a weather pattern, in which cold air from Canada meets with warm air from the Gulf of Mexico. and destabilizes the weather, and it spits out regular and vicious EF4 tornadoes. I'm not going to stand here and pretend like I know exactly what an EF4 tornado is, but I know I don't want to be in one. Nor do I want it to be a regular occurrence, but this is what happens. Cold air from Canada meets with warm air from the Gulf of Mexico, and they meet right there in this stretch of land in our beautiful U.S. and creates what is known as Tornado Alley. The reality is, despite this regular occurrence, these regular tornadoes and this threatening weather pattern, some 17 million people call Tornado Alley home. 17 million people. Now, I'll say this. I know I'm a little partial because I grew up all my life here on the East Coast, the Northeast, and shout out to everybody that's from somewhere else. God bless you. You can talk about our cold winters all you want, but I'll tell you what we don't have. We don't have mudslides. We don't have tornado season. We might get a hurricane every now and again, but that's few and far. The worst we're going to get is a nor'easter winter blizzard. And all you got to do is make sure you got what? Bread and milk and eggs. Make sure you got some oil and a plan for snow removal, and you just bunker down and let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. And so, but there are some people, 17 million, that and Tornado Alley, regular EF4 tornadoes. And as much as we may want to callously question why anybody would choose 17 million people, why they would choose to live in Tornado Alley, we have to realize that despite the storm, the familiarity and comforts of home keeps them there. You can call it Tornado Alley all you want, but to me, it's home. This is where I grew up. This is where my kids, where I got married. This is where my kids are. This is where they go to school. This is where I go to work. This is what I know. And it's not like we have a tornado every single day, Pastor Jason. And I understand that. I'm just making a point. The familiarity and the comforts of home make it, this is where they live. This is where they live. The reality is, as much as you may tell yourself, I'll never. Give me a nor'easter blizzard any day. I'm not trying to experience an EF4 tornado, not ever. As much as you may say that you'll never make your home in Tornado Alley, the reality is, spiritually, there are some people who are living in Tornado Alley in your mind, Tornado Alley in your heart, Tornado Alley in the spirit, Tornado Alley all around you, EF4 tornadoes swirling all around you, and nobody can see it. And see, that's the problem with EF4 tornadoes there in Tornado Alley, is you get warning, and they're coming up with technology to give people more and more advanced warning to be able to take shelter. But the problem with some of the tornadoes and the Tornado Alley that is happening, raging in your heart and in your mind, is that nobody else can see it. And you're smiling and you're walking around, but on the inside, there's a storm that is raging and it's blowing all around. And so before we say, I will never be one of the 17 million people that call Tornado Alley home, just consider the idea that maybe, just maybe, you or someone you're sitting next to or in this room right now, or someone in your family or someone in your community is living in a spiritual Tornado Alley every day, every day. You see, there are some people, and you may ask yourself, well, how can they just want to stay in that? Don't they know that there's a tornado brewing? Let me tell you, just like the folks that live in the physical Tornado Alley here in the U.S., folks that are living in a spiritual Tornado Alley, that the reality is sometimes you get used to it. Don't you want to come out of that? Get out of what? I went to your family reunion, and I will never go again. And they're looking at you like, why? That was normal. There were chairs flying and people yelling and screaming and nobody. It was no peace. Really? I didn't notice anything. Tornado Alley. Why? How can it happen? And I'm telling you, I'm being a little facetious, but I'm telling you this is the truth. There are some people that have just got comfortable living in a Tornado Alley in their mind and their heart and in the spirit. Some people actually shy away from drama-free environments simply because it's unfamiliar. shy away from it. You know what they'll say? It's too quiet around here. Does that mean? It's too quiet. Ain't nothing going on. No, we just had a great time at the park. It's too quiet. Take time and figure out. If you got friends that say that, take time and prod a little bit. Ask them, what do you mean by that? Because sometimes the reality is that quietness is uncomfortable. Why? Because they're not familiar with a drama-free environment. A lot of times they grow up in dysfunction. And they learn dysfunction to the point where dysfunction seems functional. If there's no drama, something's wrong. If there's no drama, somebody's not telling the truth, or somebody's not spilling the tea, or somebody said whatever it is. If there's no drama, then all of y'all are fake. Wrong! You've got used to living life in a mental, spiritual, and physical tornado alley. Fine with dysfunction. You see, as a result, the stillness of peace and unity is disturbing and abnormal, so they search for drama to be a part of. And they start finding people to hang out with that are about drama. And if they can't find someone to hang out with that's about drama, they find a show. It's about drama. The Real Housewives of Why Are You Watching This? Y'all know I like to pick on the Real Housewives, and half of them ain't even married. The Real Housewives. The real ones, as opposed to the fake ones. The Real Housewives, so they look for drama to be a part of because it's just too quiet. It's not really going on. So they look for drama. Scripted drama, by the way, might I add. Scripted drama that they go to be a part of. Why? Because they're fine with dysfunction. They become familiar with dysfunction. It's not just people concerning dysfunction. Some people are overworked and lacking rest. And when they finally get a chance to rest, they come to a place of rest and they feel uncomfortable. I'll tell them my own self. Come to a place of rest, and I'm sitting trying to rest, and I'm looking for something to do. Feeling like stuff isn't happening because I'm resting. Can I just be real with you this morning? Because going and 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 going becomes something that you get used to. And if you're not careful, if you keep going and going like that, it's just too much mental that you need to move forward, a mental capacity to do the things you need to do every single day without a rest. Everything God created needs a rest at some point. But some of us have become familiar with not having any rest. And so when you get some, you're uncomfortable. I need to be doing something. Because restlessness, you're familiar with rest. Why would anybody want to stay restless? Why would anybody not want to get rest? Because they've become familiar. You see, this idea of familiarity has a strong power and a strong grip. So there's people that will deal with a whole lot of junk simply because they're familiar with the nonsense. And so this is, I can go down the list of all kind of stuff. You see, for people like this, it may be bad, but it's familiar. We may look at a tornado alley and say, man, that's must be a challenge. That's kind of tough. It may be seem bad to you, but it's familiar to 17 million people. It's familiar. This is home. This is home. Man, don't you, there's so much chaos and nonsense going on in your household or going on in your family or going on in the community. Don't you get tired? What nonsense? What chaos? I'm used to this. It's familiar. The power of familiarity cannot be overlooked. You see, the Bible reveals this challenge that the hold of familiarity can have on us. This hold, this power that familiarity and wanting things to be familiar, it has a hold on us. And the Bible shows us in subtle ways, and in some cases not so subtle ways, just how dangerous our quest for familiarity can be. And how dangerous it can be. Because what happens when you're being called out of things familiar by God himself? But the power of things being familiar and comfortable has its grips on you. Are you hearing me this morning? And we see this throughout the Bible in subtle and not so subtle ways, but you have to read closely, you see, we see this happen. This struggle, we see it happen in two instances. And I'm sure there are more, but for today, we're just going to focus on two. And interestingly enough, the two instances take place on the water. They take place on the water. In Mark 4, there is this moment where Jesus is on the boat with the disciples. This is before our opening scripture. Our opening scripture is with Jesus and Peter steps out on the water. But before that takes place, somebody say, before that, there was another moment where the disciples are on the boat with Jesus, all of them together, and Jesus is not walking out on the water. He's in the boat. Somebody say, he's in the boat. And he's asleep in the stern of the boat. And suddenly there is a mighty sea squall. And the wind starts blowing. And the waves start crashing up against this boat. To the point where the boat starts taking on water. And the Bible tells us that the disciples get the idea finally to go in and wake Jesus. They go in and they wake Jesus. They're scared for some time before they wake him, but they wake him. And then when they wake him, Jesus says something interesting. He wakes up and he seems frustrated. And he says something similar to what he says in Matthew 14. He says, oh, you have little faith. How long will I be with you? Now in my head, when I read it, I'm thinking, well, Jesus, they did come see you. So why the light rebuke? I mean, they came to you as Jesus, as Savior, and you wake them up, and there's kind of like this slight rebuke. Why this light rebuke? Why this light rebuke? Let's look at that. This morning, I always wondered why that happens in Mark chapter 4, verse 40. And I have found out that Jesus wasn't frustrated because they woke him. You can wake Jesus. He doesn't mind. He doesn't need sleep nor slumber. Wasn't mad because they woke him. He was frustrated because of why they woke him. Well, what do you mean? Why is it that they woke him? Well, let's look at it for a moment. Didn't they do the right thing by coming to Jesus? The reality is they weren't waking Jesus up because they had high expectations that he was going to calm the winds and the waves. And I know you may read it and say to yourself, oh, well, certainly when they came to Jesus, they knew that he had the answer and that he was going to make it all right. I know you may want to think that, but there's nothing in the scripture that actually shows us that. In fact, there are things in scripture that show us that they probably didn't think that he could do anything. And I can prove it to you for a moment. Again, Jesus wasn't frustrated because they woke him. He was frustrated at why they woke him. Watch this. Let's look at Mark chapter 4, verse 41. We know that they were surprised and didn't have the expectation of Jesus being able to calm the winds and the waves because of their response. Look at what the response is. As Jesus wakes up and he goes out to the winds and the waves and he stretches forth his hand and he says to the winds and the waves, peace, be still. And the winds and the waves are calm. Look what the disciples say. And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, who can this be? That even wind and wave obey him. Doesn't that let you know? They're being surprised that Jesus calmed the storm. Lets you know that they weren't expecting him to do it. They weren't expecting it. Otherwise, they would have said, thank you, Jesus. Woo, that was a close one. Thank you for waking up. You go back to sleep now. No. Oh, my goodness. Wind and wave obey him. Somebody say they didn't know. They didn't have that level of expectation that even nature, even the winds and the waves were going to obey him. So again, I say to you, if Jesus wasn't frustrated because they woke him, he was frustrated at why they woke him. So Pastor Jason, if they didn't have high expectations that he was going to calm the winds and the waves, then why did they wake him? Look at what it says in Mark chapter 4, verse 38. It says this, but he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. Watch what they say. And they awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? They didn't wake him because they knew that he could calm the storms. They woke him because they really didn't think that he could, and he was just aloof and asleep on the job. We are out here getting ready to drown on this boat with Jesus, and he's in the back. And I mean catching Z's. Now before you look at the disciples and say, oh my goodness, how could they be scared with Jesus on the boat? How many times? How many times have you gone through a situation in your life? All you college students, you think your professor has gone nuts and he's not helping you or she's not helping you, and it seems like they have it out for you, and they just keep pressing and pressing and pressing, and it's being treated unfairly, and you're trying to do something about it, and you're going to this person and that person and that person, and everybody says, oh, well, that's just how they are. You're going to have to deal with it, but you don't want to fail your class, and so you go to the Lord and you say, Lord, help me. How come everybody else has something to say but you? Wake up. I can't fail out of school. Or you go to your boss at work and you're being treated unfairly there. Or you got stuff going on in your family. Or you got stuff going on in your health. And everybody is giving you tidbits on what you should do and how you should handle this. And the whole time you feel like there's an EF4 tornado swirling around in your life. And everybody is saying something, it seems, but Jesus. And so the disciples come. And they didn't come saying, Jesus is going to take care of this storm. And if you're real with yourself, you've had your moments where you didn't come into, you didn't come into your prayer closet like this. Oh, Jesus, I know you got this thing figured out. So I'm just going to sit here and rest and tarry. Come on, y'all. You know you've gone into your prayer closet sometime, kicked in the door. All right now, Lord. Everybody got something to say. Everybody's talking, chatting online, chatting at work, chatting to my family. Everybody got something to say. But you're the only one that's not, God, what's going on? Why are you so quiet? How could you be asleep? Y'all not talking to me. How could you be asleep at a time like this? And so Jesus is frustrated because he knows they didn't wake him up because they had high expectations of what he was about to do, because they were surprised when he did it. But they woke him up because they were frustrated because they thought he was aloof and didn't care. Out on the deep with Jesus, thinking that this was it. You see, the truth is this. Jesus expresses his frustration because their dependence was more on the familiar comfort of safety on that boat than it was the Savior who was in the boat with them. The comfort and the familiarity. These are fishermen, y'all, many of them. Comfort and safety is on the boat. We fish while on and in the boat. When there's a storm, you want to make sure you stay in the boat. Water should not be in the boat. And so they have a familiarity with this boat, and there's safety in the boat. And they wake Jesus because their familiarity and their safety was being threatened, when the whole time what Jesus wanted was for them to be familiar with the safety that only Jesus could bring. What they should have done is get familiar with Jesus so that in the middle of the storm, they're not running back and forth. I would like to think, even though I probably wouldn't, I'm just being real. I would like to think that if we were on that boat with the disciples, that instead of running back and forth and getting frustrated because Jesus is aloof and doesn't care and asleep on the job, that we would just say, you know what? If Jesus is asleep, I'm going to sleep too. If Jesus isn't saying anything, I'm just going to go and sleep. If this boat goes down right here, at least I'm going down. Because I'm not going to let the familiarity and comfort of things keep me from going into the stern to be with my Jesus. If he's asleep, I just want to lay there at his feet. And so this is how we know. This is why Jesus says, how long? What else do I got to show you to let you know? I'm not going to let you go under. I'm on the boat of life with you. And so every time you go into your prayer closet and everybody has said something except for God, and you're getting ready to shake your fist at heaven, just get to a place, if you haven't heard from him, just lie at his feet and know that he can stretch forth his hand towards your storm. And I believe as he's speaking to the winds and the waves, Bible doesn't tell us this, but I like to see it this way in my head. He's facing the winds and the waves. And it says, peace be still. And I'm believing he was also looking back. Peace be still, y'all. Who is this? That even wind and wave obey him. Who is this? That even disease and pestilence obey him. Who is this? Every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. Who, what matter of man is this? Surely this is the Son of God. So the next time you go to wake Jesus, just know that he's not asleep. He just knows. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. Y'all with me this morning? And so the role for the disciples in this case is that they should have just taken some time to get. If familiarity is what draws you, then get familiar. We're going to go into that in a moment. Now, later on in the scriptures, in Matthew chapter 14. Now this, what I just described to you, this happens, what we just talked about happens before what we're talking about in the second encounter out on the water, which is where Peter walks on the water with Jesus. So somebody say they've been here before. And that's what's interesting about this. So you would think, as amazed as they were about the winds and the waves obeying Jesus, you would think that the next time that they're out on the water with Jesus, they would be thinking, all right, it don't matter what happens now, I know Jesus got this. You would think. Matthew 14. I'm going to go from 22 to 33 in our opening scripture because I want to point some things out. We're going to read it again. Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. And when he sent the multitudes away, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening came, he was alone there. But the boat, watch this, verse 24, but the boat was now in the middle of the sea. So the disciples got in the boat right there on shore. Jesus goes up to pray. And while Jesus is praying, verse 24, while Jesus is praying, the boat ends up in the middle of the sea. Am I making this up? Right there in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves. Sound familiar? For the wind was contrary. Somebody say it was windy. The wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a ghost. And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water. So he said, come. And when Peter had gotten down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Verse 30, but when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and he began to sink. I want to pause there. There's a couple of things I want you to point out because some of y'all are looking at me wondering why I stopped there. It's probably because you missed it, but I'm going to help you this morning. A couple things I want you to notice about the scripture. Number one, it was already windy. Somebody say the wind was nothing new. How do we know that? I pointed it out to you. Jesus is praying. The disciples get in the boat. The boat ends up in the middle of the sea. Why? Did they row there? The wind was contrary. Now, nowhere in scripture do we read that the disciples are saying, as they were drifting away, Jesus, we're drifting, Lord. If you're coming, you got to come on because it's kind of windy, Lord. And to be quite honest with you, we're a little scared because the wind is against us. What I mean is contrary. The wind is contrary to us, contrary to what we would like to be doing right now. We would like to be on the shore near you, Jesus, but we're getting blown out to sea. Nowhere do we hear the disciples say a word about this contrary wind up to this point. Why is that important? I'll tell you in a second. Somebody say, it was already windy. Here's, that's the one thing I want you to understand. The second thing I want you to notice is because of the familiarity and safety of the boat, they seemed fine with the windstorm. I think that they were not as afraid as they could be because they still, at least, Jesus may be way over there to the point where we can't see him anymore, but at least we got the familiarity of this boat. It's rocking and it's rolling. And the wind is blowing against us, but at least we still have the boat. So they're okay. What's happening here? They're okay with the storm because they have something to depend on. This boat, this thing made with human hands, I'm depending on this. So let the wind blow. I'm okay. As long as I have this, I'm okay. It doesn't appear that this wind concerned Peter and the disciples up to this point, even though the wind was against them. Now, with those things in mind, the fact that the wind didn't just start and the disciples didn't seem to mind the wind this whole time they're getting blown out to sea, watch this. I want to focus on the mindset of the disciples. Though Jesus was a good distance away, the disciples get confirmation from Jesus that it is, in fact, Jesus and not a ghost. At no point did the other disciples make the effort that Peter did. You see, sometimes we focus on the fall of Peter. Yeah, he walked out and then he fell, and Jesus had to give a light rebuke. Oh, you of little faith. Again, same words. But instead of focusing on Peter for a moment, I want to focus on the disciples that stayed on the boat. Why do they get a pass? At least Peter stepped out into the deep. The rest of the disciples, you don't hear a word from them from this point where Jesus and Peter are having this interaction. All we have to put in our minds is that the disciples are on this boat, sitting back, watching the whole thing. At no point does it say, and some of the other disciples chose to follow after Peter. No, they were right there. Now, I want you to understand this. Why were they right there? Because they were convinced that it's better on that boat in a storm than out on the deep with Jesus. Sound familiar in what we talked about? Like, better in the fire with Jesus than in the world without him. The disciples are like, better in this boat. I hear you, Pastor Jason, but better in this boat, dry, than out on the deep with Jesus. And this is what is taking place. And so the disciples, they stay right there. And so this is all, mind you, despite previously seeing the power that Jesus held, they saw it with their own eyes. Even wind and wave obey him. That has already happened up to this point. And so they know that there's power in Jesus, and yet they still choose to stay on the boat even after they see Peter take his first couple of steps. Why? Because the familiarity of the boat keeps me here. Even with Jesus out on the deep, at least I have familiarity and safety. And so the disciples, not one did they step out of the boat after Peter. Are y'all hearing me this morning? For them, despite Jesus' invitation and despite him proving that he's in control of the very sea they're on, and the storm they're in, they believed, we can deduce, that maybe, just maybe for them, it was better on the boat. It's better on the boat. You see, the disciples have a problem, or they had a problem in this instance. And this is why Jesus has to say to them time and time again, oh, you of little faith. How long am I going to be with you? Why don't you get it by now? It's better with me than in anything on this earth. If I'm out on the deep, come on the deep with me. If I'm in the fire, jump into the fire. Better with me in any situation than out in the world without me. And so the disciples are having a hard time kind of grasping this. And you have to understand, it's difficult for the disciples because they're out in the deep, y'all. That's just real. We're not going to make this seem like a light situation. This was a tough situation for them. But this is what's taking place. You see, they've been convinced by perspectives and maybe the world that there's a better place to be than on the deep with Jesus. Sounds like somebody I know. I was in the car the other day and I had the radio on and this song comes on. Catchy song. I guarantee you every young adult every person 30 and under probably knows this song. And the song comes on, catchy song, the young lady can sing. And then my daughter Leah, she says, "Dad, do you hear what they're saying in the song?" And I said, "Nah, I can't quite make out what she's talking about." And she said, "This girl needs Jesus. I want to read you the lyrics. The song is called Saturn. Saturn by SZA." See, they're giggling because they know it. It says this. "Stuck in this paradigm. Don't believe in paradise. Come on. This must be what hell is like." No, it's not. "There's got to be more. Come on, let's fly through this. Sick of this head of mine. Intrusive thoughts, they paralyze. Nirvana's not as advertised. There's got to be more. Been here before. Life's better on Saturn. Gotta break this pattern of floating away. Find something worth saving. It's all for the taking. I always say, I'll be better on Saturn. None of this matters. Dreaming of Saturn. Oh, better on Saturn." Better on Saturn. And the young lady is pouring out her heart. There's got to be more. It's just chaos and confusion and hurt. And I don't believe in paradise. And so let me give some Saturn in my life. Life's better on Saturn. And the point that I'm trying to point out to you this morning is that this is the world's way of telling our young people, listen, there are better things. There are better things. If you don't like what you're feeling or like what you're experiencing, try Saturn. You don't like what you're feeling? Try this, try that, try the other. And if you don't like any of those things, just dream about living on Saturn. Do some research about what life might be like on Saturn. But instead of telling them the truth, that there is nothing that can save you, nothing that can give you peace, no one that can give you joy, no one that can give you gladness, no one that can calm the storm that you're going through like Jesus, they'd rather tell you, just think about Saturn. Just think, and trust me, there are worse songs. But I just wanted to read this one because this one is on the radio 24/7. Life is better. And so we have our young people walking around. Life's better on Saturn. What are you talking about? Come back down to earth and find you some Jesus, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Nothing. It's better than a life with Jesus. Somebody say better. It's nothing better than Jesus. And so, you know, all my 65 plus folks in the house, just make some noise real quick. I mean, I'm pointing y'all out because y'all know good music. You know good music. And all this Saturn stuff. Y'all know good music. If you know good music, make some noise. Life's better on Saturn. So you can say, life's better on Saturn. Don't think about Saturn. Think about the psychedelic shack. I set you up. Yeah, we know good music. We know good music. They don't make good music like that anymore, Pastor. They're talking about life on Saturn. Y'all were talking about the psychedelic shack, and that's where it's at. So don't act like this music is worse. Oh, you didn't think I was going there. Give them the lyrics. I told y'all last week, don't you get amnesia. Try to turn off the radio. How could you listen? Because you're saved now, but you was rocking to the psychedelic shack. Now the young people are looking like, Pastor Jason, what is the I know about Saturn. What is the psychedelic shack? I'm glad you asked. Because 65 plus, they're not going to tell you. They want you to think they were always saved and always listening to good Christian music. And this other stuff, no. We were never told to be convinced that there's something better than Jesus out there. No, that was never the message in the music. It was good and it was wholesome. Lie. Psychedelic Shack. Give me the lyrics. You can have your fortune told. You can learn the meaning of your soul. There ain't no such thing, a thing as time, time. There's no time. Don't worry about it. There's no time. Lie. Incense in the air. End signs painted everywhere. I guarantee you this place will blow your mind. Yeah. You better agree. Oh, I'm not done. Music so high, you can't get over it. So low, you can't get under it. Let me tell you where it is. Because you don't got to go far for this. Don't think you got to have all kind of money for this right here. Silver and gold, have I none. You don't need all of that for this fun. Watch this. Right around the corner. That's where it is. Just across the track. People, I'm talking about the Psychedelic Shack. And then the temps start to Psychedelic Shack. And the whole time y'all was here with it. I'm not done picking with y'all because y'all were just way too proud a moment ago. Yeah, that's bad music. We listen to good music. No, give me another verse. Psychedelic Shack, that's where it's at. Millionaires, kings and queens go there to do their things. You might see anybody there. Mm-hmm. Bearskin rugs, tails and beads. Ooh. Don't really matter what you wear. Uh-oh. You can take off your shoes, sit on the floor, join in, and be what you want to be. Don't you know that it's right around the corner, just across the track? Come on. People, I'm talking about the psychedelic. Can I give you one more? Because y'all just were so proud clapping your hands like you ain't have no bad music. Give me, go a little further. They got a cat there? Plus, help me out. I'm not trying to be on Saturn, but I'm also not. I'm not trying to party with bearskin rugs and the cat that's shouting the blues. That just doesn't sound cool to me. Let's keep going. Talking about paying some dues. People walking around reciting poetry. Screaming guitars and 1,000 colored lights. People, I'm telling you, this place is really out of sight. Some of y'all are trying so hard. You're trying so hard. This idea of presenting, this idea that there's something better out there for you. Life's better on Saturn. Don't make the mistake of thinking about Jesus. Think about Saturn. Don't think about Jesus. We got a psychedelic shack and it's right across the track. That's where it's at. And we even got a cat. Singing the blues on a bearskin rug like. And it don't cost much to be there. That's what they go on to say in the song. You don't have to have a lot of dough. What's happening? Come on. Come over here. Don't you go out into the deep. Stay right here. Go to Saturn in your mind, in your heart. Be on Saturn. Go and be in the psychedelic shack. Whatever you do, don't go. But the devil is a liar. live, because we know, and if you know like I know, there's nothing better. Somebody say better. There's nothing better than time spent in the presence of Jesus. You can have your Saturn. You can have your psychedelic shack. You can have your women, your drugs, your money. Give me. I was gonna go there, but I didn't. Somebody said I was doing just fine. On cloud. Pastor Kears, they try to leave me hanging like they didn't know the rest. Y'all are something else. Doing fine where, Pastor? On cloud nine. Jesus, it's nothing new under the sun. And as far back as you want to go, no matter what genre of music, rock and roll, doo-wop, blues, jazz, all of it, trying to lure you away from the truth of salvation and peace in Jesus. Trying to convince you that there's something better. You see, just like the disciples, there are all these influences that tell you there's better than Jesus. And I'm not trying to pick on the disciples, but I am just trying to let you know that they did not get off the boat, even after seeing Peter do what they had seen no one else do before. After it being confirmed that that was indeed Jesus out on the deep, I'm going to stay right here because it's better on the boat. How many times have you said to yourself, and nobody comes right out and says these things, but how many times have you felt like Jesus is, he's there, and I'm here, and he's calling me there, but I'm safe here. And even though I know that you stretched forth your hand and you calmed the winds and the waves of my life, and I've seen you do it, right now is better. It's better on the boat. You see, as much as we focus on Peter sinking, we have to focus on the fact that Peter had faith enough to be on a perfectly good boat, to be comfortable and feel safe on that. He was on the boat, same boat. He was on that boat with them. But I believe there's something stirred up in Peter. Something stirred up in Peter where he said to himself, I'm tired of being in this storm. This storm has blown me from the shore to the middle of the sea. And I didn't say anything. I just sat here and allowed the wind to blow me further and further away from Jesus. But I have found that there is someone walking out on the deep. And once it's confirmed that it's Jesus, I've got to get to the place in my heart where I'm no longer content to stay here in the familiarity of the boat. I'm going to ask Jesus, if it's you, call me to come out there with you onto the deep, because I can't stay in this storm. I can't stay here any longer. The disciples seemed okay. There's no scriptural proof that tells us they were concerned about the wind to the point where it blew them to the middle of the sea. But Peter sees Jesus afar off, and he says, Lord, if it's you, permit me to come out there with you. And he takes a step out onto the water. And as he steps out into the water, Jesus and the disciples are watching. And Peter, for a while, is doing something they had never seen. We've seen the water split. We've seen the water part. But the water didn't even need to split this time. Defying the laws of physics, Peter is walking out on the water. Now watch this. He's walking, and he's walking. And then the Bible says, I believe in verse 30, and when Peter saw that the wind was boisterous, why did he notice the wind then? when we've already shown that Peter knew the wind was always blowing. And so here is Peter, and he's walking, and his eyes are fixed on Jesus. And I believe what happens is this. When I travel to Liberia, to our overseas campuses, the pilot never says on a loudspeaker,
"We have now reached the Ponor, which is the point of no return. We can no longer turn back to our original place of departure. We must move forward or else we die."
They don't tell you that. But in aviation and nautical navigation, when you're traveling overseas, there is a point where as you're traveling, it's called the Ponor, the point of no return. You've gone too far. Once you pass the point of no return, to turn back. Because if you try to turn back past that point, you don't have enough fuel to get back, and you will crash before you get there. And so out of all the things that they say to you on the plane, please buckle up your seatbelts, they're going to be dispersing to whatever, all the stuff that they communicate to you on that plane. They never tell you, "All right, everybody, we have now reached the Ponor. We've reached the point of no return, so we are all systems go forward right now. Y'all better hope nothing happens to this plane from here on out. Because we can't." And here we have Peter. He takes a few steps. And we know that Jesus was afar off because they couldn't determine who he was. That's why they're like, "Jesus, if that's you." Y'all remember that? "Jesus, if it's you." So he wasn't right there up on them. He was a distance away. And so they says, "Jesus, if it's you, let me come out in the water." And so Peter, he's in, Jesus says, "Come." And Peter starts to walk. And with every step that Peter is walking is confirmation that this truly is Jesus. And he's taking one step after the other out into the deep of Jesus until he gets to a place where he notices the boisterous wind. The wind that was always blowing, suddenly it became an issue. Why? Because Peter, for a moment, I believe, he realized, "I'm out on the deep. And the reality is, this is unfamiliar territory. What's familiar is behind me. My brothers and the boat that I came here on are behind me. But what I need and what I want is in front of me. But here's the problem. What he needs and what he wants is in front of him. But that's scary too. What do you mean, Pastor Jason? How is Jesus scary?" Jesus isn't scary. But if we're being honest, the cost of following after him is. If we're being honest, the risks that you're going to have to take can be scary. The friends you'll have to lose, the people you'll have to leave behind. And so what do you do when you've come too far to go back and you're afraid to take more steps forward? Y'all are looking at me like I'm crazy, but I know I'm not. What do you do? What do you do? You're too safe to go back to where you were, what you were doing and who you were doing it with. It doesn't taste good anymore. It doesn't feel good anymore. It doesn't sound good anymore. And so you can't go back to the boat. So what do you do? In fact, it'll take more work to go back to the boat than it would to just keep moving forward towards Jesus. But with every step that he took toward Jesus, I believe there was more of him that was saying, "Man, this is some scary stuff." And sometimes this is what happens with us as Christians. As Christians, sometimes we've come too far to go back. And so you're not going back to the club, not going back to the guy, not going back to the girl, not going back to the drink, not going back to the porn, not going back to all that stuff. You're not going to do that. But what does moving forward look like? Does this mean I'm going to have to step out of my comfort zone the closer I get to Jesus, the more I got to step out of my comfort zone. The closer I get to Jesus, the more people I might lose. And so here is Peter out on the deep, too far to turn back, but it's scary moving forward. And so what does he do? He just stops. And he notices the wind. And he begins to sink. And here's the interesting thing. The scripture tells us when he begins to sink, he reaches out his hand and he grabs Peter. Oh, you have little faith. How long will I be with you? He pulls him out. This lets me know that Peter was almost, he was almost there. It doesn't say that Jesus ran as he was sinking. And he yelled, Peter, don't look at the wind. No. And he ran and he picked him up. The Bible says that he simply reached out his hand. Peter was right. Somebody say he was right there. He was right there when he began to sing. Some of you are right there. You're right there. And you're in this place where you've come too far to go back. But for one reason or other, you're afraid to move forward. And what happens when this takes place is you fall into what's called Christian complacency. I'm saved, and I'm not going back to that, but I'm not moving forward. And I'm here to tell you this morning, God is not okay with Christian complacency. I'm here to tell you this morning, they're online. God doesn't want you out there stuck out on the deep. I'm not going to GCA. Forget what they're going to teach me. I'm afraid of what I don't know. I'm not going. What if I don't know something? No, duh. That's why we have the Global Christian Academy. Wednesday night Bible study. I'm afraid of what things might be revealed to me. Serve at the church. Help the homeless. Serve our children. Join the worship team. Hospitality. Go to the men's retreat. Go to the women's tea. I'm a little socially awkward. I'm afraid. I don't know. I don't know. I just want to stay right here. I'm saved. Isn't that enough? Come too far to go back. But moving forward is scary. I'm out of here with this. Peter was in a place where he's in this boat, and a boat that's familiar. And my prayer has been for you all, and my prayer still is, that you develop the same Holy Spirit boldness that Peter had, not focusing on the fall, but focusing on the steps that Peter took. That I pray that you would get to a place where you have faith enough to step out of a perfectly fine boat to meet with Jesus. Peter had a faith mindset. Peter was faith over fear. And I'm just believing that there's somebody today that's going to have fear break off of them, and you're going to find yourself like Peter. I can't stay here on this boat. My life has been a living tornado alley, and I cannot be okay with life in a storm. And so if Jesus is out on the deep in the midst of this storm, I'm not going to be embracing familiarity. I'm going to step out of the boat. If I sink, I sink. But I've got to be out on the deep with Jesus. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but I'm believing that something is stirring up on the inside of you right now. I believe the King is killing your complacency, and you're realizing Jesus is calling you out into the deep for more of Him, for more of His will in your life, one step after the other. Somebody say, faith over fear. Can you recognize that I am He whom even winds and the waves obey? I'm telling you today. Come on, stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet all over the place. All over the place. I'm telling you today, we're out of here. I'm saying what He wants me to say. He's trying to kill the complacency in your life. Everyone who is comfortable in this room Everyone who is comfortable online, you're just in the boat, riding the waves. In some cases, completely unaware that the winds that are contrary to you have blown you further and further away from Jesus. And you didn't complain not once. Develop a faith over fear mindset. Jesus, if you're in the fire, I want to be with you. If you're out on the deep, I can't stay here. I want to be out on the deep with you. So if that means I got to leave the very people that I've learned with and grown with and whatever, but if they're cool with complacency, I can't stay here. Bid me to come out on the water with you. Is there anybody here this morning? It's an altar call for everyone in this room and everyone online. If you recognize today that nothing's changed, God is still out on the deep. And the dreams that he put inside of you from when you were a child, even though the world tried to kill it and stomp it and rip it out of you, Jesus is bidding you to come. Come out into the deep. Kill the complacency and choose faith over fear. And know that I got you. If you're here this morning and that's you, I just want you to come before we even do a salvation call. And you want to walk out into the deep with Jesus. I just want you to come to this altar. I just want to pray for you today. And you can't come to the altar because you're not here physically. But there's an altar right there in your home. As you've created an atmosphere of worship right there in your living room. Or right there in your kitchen. If somebody's distracting you, tell them, no, you got to go right now. I'm getting ready to step out into the deep. And we're going to pray a powerful prayer. Very simple prayer, but it's a powerful prayer. And I need you to understand, like I always say, it's not that there's more power per se at this altar than there is in your seat, for the tabernacle is within. But this is a physical representation of what we're doing in the spirit. I'm taking steps towards you, Lord. I'm taking steps towards you. All over this place, with your head bowed and eye closed, just lift your hands like this. And I want you to say this. Lord, in the name of Jesus, kill any complacency that's keeping me from you. Kill any complacency that's got me afraid to walk out to meet with you in the deep. On this day, I am consciously choosing faith over fear. Bid me to come to you out onto the deep. Lord, look upon these your children. As we recognize, Heavenly Father God, that they are here to say, Lord, I'm willing to step out onto the deep with you. I know I'm not going to be okay with my storms because I know that you can calm them. I'm not going to be killed by complacency, too not going back, but too afraid to move forward. No, God, I want to get as close to you as possible. Peter was right there. He was right there. God, I want to go all the way. I want to go all the way, oh God. So please, in the name of Jesus, have your way in me. God, continue to do in them what only you can do. Lord God, the ministries, oh Father God, the serving you're calling them to do, the ministering you're calling them to do, the praying you're calling them to do, the stepping out on faith you're calling them to do, the business you're calling them to have, the people you're calling them to confront, the souls that you're calling them to reach out to so that they can be saved, the disciples that you're calling them to meet with and to pull them into the fold of Jesus Christ. says, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we will not let complacency kill us. Oh God, but we have a Peter mindset that says I'm choosing faith over fear, even if I got to do what nobody else has done. Jesus, you're out on the deep. Bid me to come with you, oh God. We prayed about it earlier. We sang about it earlier. Start a fire. Revival can start with me. God, have thine own way in the name of Jesus as you call us out into the deep. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. If you said that prayer and you meant it, say amen and give the Lord a praise. Come on out into the deep. Come on out into the deep. The water's fine, I promise you. Come on out into the deep. And right there before we leave, I just want to pray for anybody that doesn't know Jesus. You don't know him as Lord and Savior. And you have been drawn away by all the stuff that I talked about today. You've been thinking about Saturn or Psychedelic Shack or whatever else that they've been trying to tempt you with to convince you that there's better than Jesus. But today you realize, no, something about what that preacher is saying, I believe 100% there's nothing better than the Jesus I've been running from. And in that Jesus, you can be saved from the grips of hell and be forgiven and qualified by his blood. You have a chance right now. You're one prayer away. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you're here and you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior for the first time in your life, I just want you to come up here and I want to pray for you. If you're here, just wave your hand at me and say, no, I don't have Jesus and I want him. I know about him. I've heard about him. I've read about him. But I can't say that I've accepted him into my heart and had somebody say the sinner's prayer over me. If that's you, just lift your hands nice and high. Don't let this be the moment that passes. This might be your stepping out into the deep. Your first opportunity to step out into the deep is right here. If there are none, I pray for you online. Because maybe you're there online and you're saying, I want to take that step out into the deep. I want to call you my Lord and Savior. I don't know that if I died today, if I would go to heaven or hell. But I want to be sure. And I know the only way to be sure is by you, Jesus, and your sanctifying, qualifying blood. Let us pray. Father, thank you for this moment. Thank you for saving me and giving me the opportunity to receive you as Savior. Lord, I believe that you suffered, that you died, and were buried. And on the third day, you rose again, like the Bible said you would. And you ascended into heaven, and you've given me the gift of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I receive that gift. Fill me right now from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. Lord, on this day, you are mine. And finally, I am yours. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. As you go to your seats, let's just thank the Lord for the word today. If you can just give a clap offering to God for that powerful word. God is good. That word will prosper in the thing that he sent it. Couple of announcements just before we close out. One, we have e-groups 4 to 6. It's a potluck at the church today. And we also have next week temple time. Next after church on Sunday, we have temple time. That will be in the announcement. But everybody's welcome to come out today for the e-groups, okay? And there'll be some food, so we'll be there. So bow your heads. Let's just dismiss. Father, we thank you for your grace and for your peace. We thank you for your word that is true, your word, Heavenly Father, that is powerful. And Lord, we ask for the grace, Heavenly Father, to be where you are, the grace to overcome any fear, the grace to stand strong, to get off the boat where we need to get off the boat. We have recognized that there is nothing in Saturn, nothing in the psychedelic shack, Heavenly Father. We just want to be in you in the name of Jesus. We commit this week as we go out, asking that your grace and peace will be multiplied in Jesus' mighty name. And all the saints said, amen. Amen.